I started really using Ruby full-time a little over 2.5 years ago, but I'm also a concurrency lover, so I'm really a JRuby lover because it allows me to have my cake and eat it too. I'm a Ruby Ninja at Talkdesk. That's an actual post. I'm pushing for it, and that's my post. And you can Twitter, you can follow me on Twitter and say Twittery things to me, and I'll reply back. So. Okay, so yeah, fake news. So before talking about the future, I'd like to go on a quick historical interlude. So MRI Ruby. What is MRI Ruby? MRI Ruby is what we normally refer to when we say Ruby. It's Matt's Ruby interpreter. It's the default Ruby implementation. You can some people also call it C Ruby because it's written in C. It was created by the creator of Ruby, Yukihiro Matsumoto, also known as Matt. And it is the most widely used Ruby. When you hear someone say, "I use Ruby," probably they're using MRI. And also, if you use Ruby, you're probably using MRI. And it actually defines what Ruby is. Because unlike some other languages, there is not a real formal specification for Ruby. There is a formal specification for a subset of Ruby, but not really for the entire Ruby. So basically, Ruby is what whatever MRI says it is. So until MRI 1.8, MRI's implementation was pretty simple and pretty straightforward. So it had a simple AST interpreter. So your code was represented as a tree, and then MRI would just walk that tree and interpret it, and thus your code would run. It also employed a very simple garbage collection algorithm using mark and sweep. So the idea is that MRI stopped your application entirely, sweeps the entire heap, and any references it didn't find, it would drop them as garbage, and then your application would be restarted, and you would have a pretty big pause when doing so. It also has the famous GIL, or the Global Interpreter Lock, which basically protects Ruby in a way that it only allows one thread at a time to be running. So you can use threads in Ruby. Ruby has concurrency, so there can be multiple things going on in Ruby, but not parallel, because only one thread at a time will be doing Ruby work in MRI, and the GIL is the global lock or mutex, whatever you want to call it, that protects it. So at one at a time. About 10 years ago, we got Ruby 1.9. This was when Ruby and MRI really started moving forward in terms of performance. We got the YARV bytecode interpreter that's completely replaced the previous interpreter, and this was done by Koichi Sasawa, which is a very big contributor to the core MRI in the core MRI team. And at the time, Zendesk, which used Ruby, not sure if still uses it nowadays, it said they ported their code from an older version of Ruby, and they found a really big speed up for their workload, so it was really great. So fast forward a couple of releases, and we in Ruby 2.1, Ruby still got a lot a very improved garbage collection algorithm, which is the RGEN-GC, which works in based on generation. So instead of stopping your entire program and doing the whole process of the garbage collection, your heap is actually divided into multiple generations. And the idea is that objects either die very, very soon because you are always creating objects and they are always turning into garbage, or objects live a long time. So the idea is that you keep objects that live, you graduate objects that live a long time into a special section of the heap, and you collect that section less often, so less time spent in bottom. So this was also by Koichi Sasawa. And this kind of establishes a pattern of Koichi Sasada being a very the biggest contributor of performance improvements on MRI. In MRI 2.2, we got incremental and generational GC. So the idea of incremental GC is that instead of you pausing the application to sweep an entire generation, Instead, you would bunch up parts of the garbage collection work between executing code, and so instead of having one big pause, you would have very tiny pauses that hopefully you would not notice. And surprise, again, Koichi Sasada was the one that implemented this. And we also got, finally, the famous symbol GC, which means that now we can use symbols at will and don't have to worry about memory leaks regarding symbols. Because before that, every symbol was kept in an internal memory table and was never collected. So this was a very big improvement. And funny enough, you can see that in the contribution, it says that the idea is by Koichi Sasada, which is not really a surprise. So enough history. Let's talk about a bit about the future of MRI. With MRI 3, as also touched in the previous presentation, there's a target which is 3x3, or that Ruby 3.0 will be 3 times faster than Ruby 2.0. So that's a general target. The Ruby developers don't yet know how they'll get there, but they know that they want to choose a couple of benchmarks, and then when we get Ruby 3.0, hopefully the benchmarks would be at least 3 times faster than we have in 2.0. So one of those benchmarks is OptCaret, which is a NES emulator, and basically you measure frames per second, and I'll get back to OptCaret a little later. So also, for MRI 3, as we were discussing before, there's the idea of creating Ruby guilds. And Ruby guilds are a new concurrency model for Ruby, which groups threads into guilds. So the idea is that to solve the problem of Ruby having the global interpreter lock, a single lock that is shared by all threads and only allows one at a time to run, instead you kind of think of, you group threads into guilds, and you have one guild for this, one guild for that, one guild for some other thing, and inside the same guild, there's a global interpreter lock for that guild, but different guilds have different global interpreter locks. So you can have multiple threads inside the same guild, and they'll still be one at a time, or multiple threads between guilds working all in parallel, or if you really want to, you probably can use one thread per guild, and so all of your threads will be working in parallel. The interesting part of this is that since this kind of parallel programming brings some issues and some hazards, the idea is that communication will be only via message passing and not really shared memory. The current status of this is a proposal. This is kind of the second proposal for a concurrency model for Ruby 3. There was a previous one by Matt in which he wanted to have like a flow kind of construct, but he has said that the guilds he thinks is a better model for Ruby. But we'll see if this one is the one that sticks or not. But it's by Koichi Sasada, so it's very probable that it will stick because he's the one doing the code most of the time. Also, in the future for MRI, Tenderlove or Aaron Patterson has been working on some improvements to Ruby's garbage collection. One of them is compacting GC. So the idea is that when you drop unused objects from a memory page, you create fragmentation. So the idea of a compacting GC is defrag. Basically, you compact your memory again so that instead of using 1,000 pages each with a single live object, you compact them again and you have 3 or 4 pages with all of those objects again. Other thing that Tenderlove is also working on is having separate heaps for classes and modules and etc. So the idea here is these are rarely collected, so you probably don't want to run GC cycles there very often. And also when you use forking web servers like Unicorn, and here it's important to say Aaron Patterson works for GitHub, which uses a forking web server. You can share a lot more memory pages with copy and write if you have separate heaps for classes and modules. So this saves up memory. So the current state of this is soonish. So we'll probably see it 1 year, 2 years from now, but it's still work in progress. So Another thing that's in the cards in the future for MRI is the deoptimization engine. So the deoptimization engine is not by Koichi Sasada, and it's still a work in progress, but already worked in a lot of cases. So the idea of the deoptimization engine is to deoptimize Ruby code. And you might be asking, well, why do you want to optimize Ruby code? Ruby is already slow, why am I adding something that serves to deoptimize Ruby code? But the idea is that it's a bit counterintuitive, but deoptimization is actually very key to performance. Because deoptimization enables speculative optimization, which is, for instance, if you have a very hot method which is doing a lot of numerics, you have to, every time you need to call a method to do a plus or an integer and something like that. But actually, what you want is, if you are working on integers, you probably want to use use operations from your hardware, not really method calls to do this. So the idea is that you can speculate that, well, nobody really messed with integer plus, so it's really a normal plus that I can use the hardware plus and not a method call. So I can use it, but if someone decides, well, I'll monkey patch plus because that's very cool and I'm a very, very hot Ruby developer, then you can undo your optimization and your code is still correct. So the idea of the optimization is that you can speculate, you can say, well, I'm pretty sure that I can do this, and you can, until the day that you find that you can't, and then you automatically regress, and it's all cool and your code is never incorrect. So, moving on to other Ruby implementations. One of the Ruby implementations I wanted to talk about, which is a new Ruby implementation, it's called Ruby plus OMR. So the OMR, Eclipse OMR project is basically a project by IBM where they contributed their J9 Java virtual machine into an Eclipse project, and they are working to break the virtual machine into several high-level components. They are breaking into a JIT engine, a garbage collector, some instrumentation, blah blah blah, and so you can have pieces of a virtual machine, and the idea is that you then can then take a piece of this virtual machine and glue it onto something else. So the idea of Ruby plus OMR, as you might be getting there, is to have put this OMR components on top of MRI. So right now there's a tech preview out there, you can use it, but it's still not very performant, they are still working on it. So OMR includes OMR GC, and they are using the GC from the OMR project. And most interestingly, they are using also the JIT compiler engine from OMR. So this is probably, if this works out, it's probably going to end up on MRI, and it's going to be the thing that boosts MRI. You can also use some of IBM's open source monitoring tools, which is very cool. You can see the state of memory and the JIT engine and all that, and you can use them on MRI. A few months ago there was an interesting tweet by Chris Seaton, which is works on another Ruby implementation, that, and he said that, I know of two people working on secret Ruby JITs for MRI. So maybe it's not going to be Ruby plus OMR, but there seems to be a lot of activity around writing a JIT engine for MRI. This is very good because we are most of us use MRI. an interesting fact is that in the past there was a JIT for MRI called RuJIT, and it did work, but it was not very good. So they abandoned it, and it was never merged into MRI. So another Ruby implementation is that you might not have heard about is mRuby, which is another Ruby implementation by Matt. But the difference is that mRuby is ahead of time compiled to machine code. This is kind of different from the normal Ruby, and the idea is that it's based off the Ruby 1.8. More specifically, it's an implementation of an ISO spec for Ruby, which is basically Ruby 1.8. But since it's Ruby 1.8 and it's AOT compiled, it's not dynamic. So basically, you can't run anything that you have right now, won't run on mRuby, and the idea is that it will never run, probably. So, but it's very useful for embedded apps, for doing small shell scripts, Or if you wanted to embed it into something else, for instance, instead of using Lua, you can add mRuby into your whatever application, and you can script it using Ruby. So that's very cool. So now on to my favorite, which is JRuby. JRuby is, I believe, the Ruby implementation that gets you the best performance and true parallelism right now, that it's usable in production. It's basically just Ruby on top of Java. It's nothing more and nothing less. The current status is that it's over 9,000 and it's ready to be used in production. And at Talkdesk, we use JRuby in production. So the main key points from JRuby is that it's faster than MRI. It has no gil, so you can use true parallelism, and you can have multiple threads and they will all work at the same time. And the Java garbage collector is miles ahead of whatever Ruby does, because, well, when Ruby started getting a generational GC, Java already had very advanced GCs with millions of money of research and development put on them, so it's really doesn't compare. So you can use Ruby web servers with Puma, or you can call whatever language of JVM language you like. It's very easy. You can also use Java web servers. And one very interesting thing is that you can deploy your entire application using a single jar for a standalone application or a WAR file, which is a Java web archive. So the idea is that if you want to deploy, for instance, to Amazon, you can just build one file with your entire Ruby application, and it will run in all operating systems where Java runs, and it's really simplified, and you don't have to have bundler and gems and files everywhere on your server if you don't want to. One file. It also has a lot of cool tooling. So for instance, you can have memory visualization. Here I'm showing the multiple heap generations for a running application. You can see that as it collects, they go down. You can see the space of the multiple heaps that you have, and you can also monitor the application and trigger GCs and see how much memory your application is using. It also has tools like live allocation and heap dumping. So for instance, you can see live what your application is doing. So this is a live application that's working, and we can see new things are being allocated, new things are being freed. You can also use an option which is the deltas option. This option allows you to see what's the difference between the previous snapshot. So you can see what instances are being created. So for instance, a lot of new relic trace nodes and contact stuff, which is what this application does. It works with contacts, so we can really see what instances are being created live with a live application. And we can also take a snapshot and go into it, and we'll get there. You can also see, I forgot, before that you can also see per thread allocation. So this application is using 12 threads, and we can see how much memory each thread is generating. And so you can see, well, I'm getting a lot of garbage, a lot of instances, which thread is doing so. In this case, all threads are working on a single problem, so it's kind of even. And now I take a heap dump, and I can see all of the instances in the heap. I can go into each one of them, and anytime, yes. You can see, you can filter by Ruby instances, for instance like this, and you can go into them and see what references back. So these are back references. So this means the object that references object that is being shown. Finally, you can look at thread utilization and the state of current threads. So you can see what are my threads working, what's going on. So you can see right now all of these threads are idle. So they are white in orange. And so when I add some load to the application, we'll see that the threads will turn to green because they are working. And so you can see, why are my threads not working? Are they all working? For instance, In red, it means that threads are stopped on some lock, so you can see that at the beginning they share some lock, but then they start working fine. And you can also use profilers, so here's an example. I'm using NetBeans to profile a live application, and we can see that the application, the methods that the application is running right now, and we can see how much time it's taking in real time. So this is a live application. Okay, so for the feature of the Ruby, since I'm talking about the feature of Ruby implementations, we're still, the Ruby developers are still working on adding support for Ruby 2.4, which came out in December, so it still implements Ruby 2.3, so it's slightly behind of the latest MRI release. They are also working on the optimization. As I said, the optimization is the cool thing on the block, so everyone wants to do the optimization now, and the optimization will get it even going faster, because speculative optimization. And they are also working on using the Graal compiler, which is a new shiny compiler for the Java virtual machine that allows you to really optimize very special use cases, such as JRuby, and so that's probably going to yield a lot more performance. Disadvantages of JRuby, it has slow startup, so I recommend you use this option --dev and use bundler bin stubs if you're using it in development, because it starts a bit slow, and this helps. It has no support for C extensions, so if you're using some C extension from MRI, it used to be a lot worse. So nowadays, with 2017, most of the gems have Ruby alternatives or JRuby specific alternatives, so you probably don't have to search around, and in some cases the gem already selects the MRI backend or the JRuby backend automatically, so you don't even have to worry. But if you have some specific C extension that you wrote, it doesn't work. It only works if you use FFI, which is another way of writing C extensions, but it's not very common. For instance, the Typefuse HTTP client uses FFI, but it's not very common. So probably some gem that you want that uses a C extension will probably not be using FFI. But if you want to write something that works in both, go ahead, use FFI, it will work on both. It also has no gil, and I've listed this as an advantage and as a disadvantage, because since MRI has the gil, there is still some Ruby code that kind of assumes that the gil is there, or not really assuming. Someone wrote it, they tested it, and they said, well, it works, and then when you remove the gil and you have multiple threads working on something, it fails. So it's kind of a disadvantage. As I said, right now this is much better than it was, let's say, 5-6 years ago. Rails 5 is ready for concurrency, a lot of other frameworks are ready for concurrency, so this is not as big as a problem as it was. And in Talkdesk, in our JRuby applications, I just once had to fix a bug related to this. This is an example, I'm not saying that you won't find problems, but yeah. If you are careful and you write functional code, because functional code also doesn't have side effects, you won't have any problems, so that's the trick. So also in production, you might need to do a bit of tuning for memory, but I have a previous presentation that goes into detail on this, but yeah, it's doable. So let's talk interesting. Let's talk Truffle Ruby. What is Truffle Ruby? You might have heard its previous name as JRuby Truffle, which is kind of a misnomer, because you kind of have had two Ruby implementations living in the same Git repository in the same project, but they kind of did not share a lot. And as time went on, they shared less and less, and a couple of months ago, finally they decided, well, let's get our own repo and let's fork. So it's now a separate project, but I like to call it the Ruby World Domination Engine, and I will show why in a second. So it's a new Ruby. It has 4 years. It's pretty new, but it has backing by Oracle. A lot of people from Oracle Labs are paid to work full time on this. So it employs speculative optimization, which is awesome, and the optimization did something they already do. And it uses a very special Java framework called Truffle, which does magic and allows you to implement programming languages pretty easily and have very good performance in that implementation. So it's very good, and besides Ruby, there are implementations of R and I believe JavaScript and some other languages. So it really makes simple writing language implementations which work fast. And Truffle Ruby is an example. So I was talking about OpCaret before, and here it is running on Truffle Ruby. So we can see that it starts on the low FPS, but as it warms up and then the JIT engine kicks in and starts to optimize and speculative optimize, we can see that the frames rise until we get to a state where we are at 150 FPS. So this is after optimization. Sometimes it still dips, but it's really, you can see the magic working. And you can also see a pretty graph. In red we have MRI, so MRI never optimizes, so always 20 frames per second. Perfect, yeah. Both JRuby in green and TruffleRuby start lower, so it starts slower because it has warm up and all that. But JRuby, after warming up, it takes a while to warm up, but then you get 40 FPS about flat, so this was in line with what I've told you. JRuby is faster at single-threaded code than MRI, and you can have multiple threads. But when TruffleRuby really starts going well, you don't have a comparison. It really gets going. So the current status of TruffleRuby, as of right now, it passes 100% the Ruby length specs. And it passes most of the active whatever support, whatever, from Rails gems. And you might be asking, well, if you have 100% in Ruby specs, why do you not have 100% in the active whatever? This is because the Ruby specs are not comprehensive, as I've said. The only Ruby spec the true Ruby spec is what MRI does and what's in Matt's head. So sometimes you find an issue and you have to ask Matt, is this expected from MRI? And Matt will tell you yes, and then that's what Ruby does. And then Matt will say no, it's a bug, and then MRI needs to be fixed. But that's the state of things. So that's why you can have 100%, but still not support everything. But it's really getting there. And actually, it's kind of funny, and the Truffle Ruby developers are always talking about it. This is more than any other Ruby implementation. So not even JRuby gets 100%, and it works fine. So right now, it has no support for C extensions, also like JRuby. It also does not have support for Java or JRuby extensions. So this is kind of a problem. Since, as I've said, most things that have MRI C extension, they also have a JRuby alternative. So the problem with TruffleRuby is that right now you can use neither. You can't use the C extension nor the Java extension. So you're kind of stuck if there is not a pure Ruby implementation of the